We're here in Maokong, high above Taipei City, where my co-hosts Emma and Leslie have never been. So we're here to enjoy some of the local tea. I'm here to introduce them to one of my favorite tea houses. Later on, I'll be speaking to some of the tea shop owners around here about how COVID and climate change are affecting their business. We'll also hear from our partners at Voice of America about what American people think of Taiwan. And Leslie in hashtag Taiwan will be introducing an unsung hero. This is Taiwan Insider.
Like Staś said in the introduction, we're up in the high mountains of Taipei in Maokong, a place that produces some of the best teas in the entire world. This place is literally packed with tea plantations. Staś has been up here a few more times than either I or Emma, so he knows some of the secret tea houses that really know how to brew a good cup. Surprisingly, there's more to it than just putting tea to water.
To many, bubble tea is Taiwan's signature drink. And it's a huge global business worth over $2 billion. But hidden in the forests above Taipei, Maokong sells tea the traditional way. No boba, no milk, just leaves, hot water, and a whole tray of paraphernalia. We're here to learn how to make it. First step is to place the teapot onto the tea boat first, and then open the lid of the teapot. Okay, Emma, do you wanna?
Okay, so.
Ready? There you go. And open the lid of the teapot. Now you pour hot water into the teapot, and that's to warm the teapot up. I can do that. So pour the hot water into the teapot. Oops. To warm it up.
This sounds about right. This sounds about right.
Yeah. Now you pour it out again.
Definitely so, a lot more steps than I remember making tea in the US. It just involves getting a tea bag, putting in some water, and putting
in
the microwave.
Right? That's what I do. What's the... Then no, my grandma's going to start yelling at me.
So this is going to go in here, and this is, again, just for warming the cup, because I guess the logic being that if your cup isn't warm, the tea doesn't taste as good. Now, put the appropriate amount of tea leaves into the teapot.
Now, they don't tell you what the appropriate amount is, so I'm just doing some guesswork here.
So here we go. Ooh. All right, it's in.
Okay, one Mississippi, two Mississippi, three Mississippi. Oh, yeah.
Beautiful pour.
Now pour the tea into the smelling cup. I'm actually gonna hold this up just so I can, for ease of access. So now smell it, Leslie.
Smells, it's a little fragrant. Yeah. I feel like we could have used a little more tea leaves, but...
So Emma, I will pour you some of this. I think quite mild tea, I think it's fair to say.
Pretty mild right now.
Cheers.
Cheers, I already drank mine, so you guys, I gun my bay.
It's got a nice subtle flavor.
I think you're right, I think we could have used more tea leaves. Well, that's pretty much how to brew tea. Making tea the old-fashioned way isn't as easy as buying from a store, but the fact Maokong thrives on this centuries-old ritual is proof that convenience and tradition can live side by side.
Now, like we said, Maokong grows some of the best teas in the entire world. With such a long and storied history of tea growing, well, recent changes to the environment, like climate change or the pandemic, certainly have affected tea output and tea consumption. Staś Butler spoke to a few tea house owners to find out just exactly how they've been affected.
当然疫情开始之后，观光客就变成几乎是零了，几乎是零了，对，但是。 因为现在台湾人没办法出国，那再加上说因为疫情的关系，大家就不喜欢在密闭空间，所以我们疫情之后的营业状况是还可以了，因为就是台湾人变多了，台湾人来山上喝茶的人变更多，对。疫情的影响，当然对于经济的各方面呢、行动呢、出入啦，反正就出行很会造成相对影响，还有我们的制造成本也会增加。那我们 只有呢，在这疫情里面，一边像等修养时间去将茶园的管理做得更好，然后呢，一边在等待它下次的经济 活络的时候再行出发。到这一点我倒是觉得蛮乐观的啦。对啦，因为毕竟我们是原在地这边，我们不是说只是短期来这边工作的，所以虽然它有影响，但是我们还是保持比较正面的状态，是因为这样的疫情让我们可以得到休息，不只有人，还有土地跟我们的茶树。
像去年呢，下雨就很少，然后就茶叶就长得不太好，那我们就要另外就是有那个喷水的那个管线，就会比较辛苦了。然后那个做茶的时间也会稍微会有变化，不过这都还在可以去控制的范围内了。
对于茂空这边，我们也不可能说是独善其身，因为你在一个大环境里面，但是小区域的话，我觉得影响它不是挺大，因为植物跟人一样，它会随着气候的变迁而调节自己本身对于它的适应性，也就是说只要它活着它会有免疫。那另外一方面一部分就是说，你看我们这样的这个整个地区的山哈，我们是保持原来的原貌，我们没有去开发，过度的开发，没有把树砍掉，所以即使它现在外面温度上升有一度两度一度半，可是呢当它太阳下山以后，这个温度很快就会降下来，而不是像都市的状态。都市它原本它有河流有绿地，可是因为它现在都是盖房子，水泥很多，我们倒是比较担心都市的建设太快来影响我们这个，反倒我们自己本身的环境去影响都市相对少的。
Now, Maokong is one of the most popular tourist destinations in Taipei, but unfortunately, foreign tourists haven't been able to access it. Since the pandemic began, Taiwan has blocked international tourists from coming into the country. However, that doesn't mean that people outside of Taiwan have stopped having an opinion about it. Our partners at Voice of America decided to interview some people to see what they think of when they think of Taiwan.
In the 1940s, with the communist revolution in China, the democratic government of China fled to what was called Formosa and is now Taiwan. And the government of the mainland China claimed sovereignty over Taiwan as well.
I don't know very much about it, but I know my grandfather used to live there during his high school years and college years, actually, too.
Taiwan is a role model for many countries to follow. Very enterprising people. They made a space in the semiconductors.
Taiwan is really an incredible place. I think it might look small on a map, but it really punches above its weight in terms of innovation and dynamism and natural beauty.
Taiwan, the thing I think of is democracy.
I think at this time, I think about the tension that's between Taiwan and China.
Very enterprising and hardworking people of Taiwan.
I think hope. I think that there's been a lot of anxiety in recent years about the state of global democracy and what democracy looks like in this new era. And Taiwan fought really hard to make the democratic progress that it has.In recent decades, the older generations there still remember, living under an authoritarian government. And so in this era of democratic backsliding, we see Taiwan's democracy continuing to grow stronger. And I think that's a really powerful message of hope for other democracies around the world.
That's a country that is an adversary to most of the democracies. They are a threat to any democracy.And human rights.
Let's say challenge. I think that there's a pretty broad consensus nowadays that there are just some fundamental differences between the values that the U.S. Holds dear and some of China's governing principles. But at the same time, it is, you know, the other major power in the world.
U.S. relations with China have sort of waxed and waned, but you know, China is a giant superpower, and we need to, you know, live cooperatively and peacefully.
Next up, take a look at some other stories that are on our radar.
Taiwanese officials and business persons have been searching for new markets for farmed grouper. That's after China banned imports of the fish last week. Chinese authorities say imports contain banned substances. China was the biggest importer of Taiwanese grouper. Authorities in southern Taiwan are already working with Japanese business persons to sell more grouper in Taiwan. Speaking at an event to promote the fish, Premier Su Zhenchang on Tuesday said that this isn't the first time China has pressured Taiwan. The same day, the Agriculture Council announced it would reform the management of grouper exports. Taiwan has relaxed vaccination requirements for tour groups. Previously, participants had to have received 3 doses of a COVID vaccine, but that indirectly limited traveler numbers. Many tour group travelers are over the age of 65. Only half of people that age have received 3 doses. Now, participants can show a negative COVID-19 rapid test taken within 48 hours of the tour starting. Business persons are welcoming the move, saying it will help restore the industry. But some experts fear removing the 3-dose requirement will lead to more people getting sick. An earthquake struck Taiwan on Monday at 9:05 a.m. It registered a 6.0 on the Richter scale. The tremor occurred along the Central Mountain Range fault line. Seismologists say earthquakes along that fault line are rare, but tension continuously builds in that area, meaning that when quakes do occur, they're usually longer and have more aftershocks. Experts say 2022 could have an unusually large amount of seismic activity. This year has already had 8 quakes over magnitude 6.0. The year on record with the most earthquakes over that size was 1999 with 13.
Before we leave you, Leslie reflects on the life of an unsung hero in hashtag Taiwan. This week, I want to pay tribute to a person who's made the world a little safer. There's a popular internet adage that goes, "Not all heroes wear capes." And while this week's hero didn't wear a cape, he rode around on a scooter carrying an aluminum ladder and a handful of rags. This is 80-year-old Zhang Xiuxiong, a retired construction worker, and he did a great service for northern Taiwan. If you drive in Taiwan, you know the roads can get a bit treacherous and chaotic. Streets can get narrow and turns can get sharp. And that's not really anyone's fault, it's just the nature of Taiwan's geography. Taiwan and its cities are quite small, and you don't have big, wide open roads like you might have elsewhere. One of the most important tools on Taiwan's streets are convex mirrors. They help you see oncoming cars at tight intersections and mountainous roads. I can only speak for myself, but these convex mirrors are a huge help when it comes to driving safely. You see, when he was 68 years old, Zhang witnessed a traffic accident when he was out one day. He noticed that the convex mirror at the site of the accident was covered in spider webs. Zhang came to the conclusion that had the mirror been clean, then the accident may have been avoided. So Zhang took it upon himself to start cleaning traffic mirrors all around northern Taiwan. Zhang woke up at 3 or 4 a.m. every day and rode around cleaning mirrors for free. It's estimated that Zhang cleaned over 150,000 mirrors. And I'm certain such an act of charity and selflessness has prevented countless car accidents and saved dozens of lives. In 2019, New Taipei City's Transportation Department acknowledged Zhang's work and thanked him for his contributions in a press release. The city's transportation department then filmed and released a documentary about Mr. Zhang sharing how he goes about his day, making the streets safer. As you might imagine, people were blown away. He was colloquially dubbed the Traffic Mirror Buddha. Unfortunately, earlier this week, news surfaced that Mr. Zhang passed away on June 8th. He was 80 years old. People online couldn't believe it and expressed their sadness on social media. According to media reports, Zhang's niece said that he was a good man who did good things his entire life. And I believe it. You don't go around cleaning 150,000 street mirrors out of the kindness of your own heart if kindness didn't permeate every fiber of your being. It's interesting how people you never met can affect your life. For me at least, whenever I drive past a traffic mirror now, I can't help but wonder if Mr. Zhang cleaned that one before. And we're back in the studio for our final question of the day, and this week's question is going to be, what was your favorite part of Maokong? Now, I'm a little more curious about what Emma has to say, because I know Stash has been up there several times, and he's got time to think about it. But, you know what?
Staś, let's start with you. What was your favorite part of Maokong?
Well, my favorite part was actually just after we finished filming, we went for a nice kind of tea lesson. Yeah. I think that's how I'd describe it. Thought that was really fascinating, him giving us, well, him certainly brewing tea a lot better than we did.
You shared a lot.
And also, like, how often do you really get to just sit down with a nice cup of tea with your friends? It's always like, you know, grab and go, and this was just nice to relax and chat.
I mean, several cups of tea.
Several very tiny cups of tea.
He just kept brewing.
I thought he'd never stop. What about you?
So mine was the gondola ride.
Ah.
It was really cool because the gondola that we were on, like, it was glass at the bottom so you could see straight down. And also just as we were going over, we could see the tea plantations and just also see all of Taipei. And I just felt like it was an amazing angle to be able to look at the city from and also be able to see all of the beautiful natural scenery as well.
It was definitely very different, I will say that.
I mean, like, I think, you know, even in its own right, it's like a thing worth doing. I mean, apart from the fact you end up at Maokong, it's still, you know, amazing.
It's definitely very nice. Well, Staś, you and I are on the same wavelength because I myself found myself very fascinated by, and if I can get this open, Mr. Chang's lesson. actually, I should clarify, I'm talking about a Mr. Chang up in Maokong and not Mr. Zhang, who I talked about in hashtag Taiwan. Though I appreciate both of them for very different reasons. Mr. Zhang, he was very knowledgeable about tea.
I mean, also, we had two Mr. Zhangs in my video, so
they're
all called Zhang.
Actually, that's very interesting because he said that 90% of people up in Maokong, they have the last name Zhang. Because they descended from the same place in China, apparently.
They're all the same clan.
It's all the same clan, so there's a reason why Zhang is so ubiquitous up there. And that's one of the many things you learn when you have a local tea master brewing tea for you. Anyway, that's about all the time we have for this week's edition of Taiwan Insider. We'll be back with another edition next week. But for now, I'm Leslie Liao.
I'm Staś Butler.
And I'm Emma Bennett.
Make sure you follow us on our social media channels. You can catch us on Facebook, YouTube.
We're also on Instagram.
Yeah, and we're also on Twitter. And if you'd like to send us a message, tell us what you think about the show, feel free to do that. But until next week, guys, we'll see you around.